adjust the audio transmission. The Avronaut is a runaway slave from the past and the future. The Avronaut is now in control of this transmission. The Avronaut is here to collect and redistribute reparations. To undo the ignorance of the white people. And white-ish people. And non-black people. The Avronaut will define reparations. Reparations are creating, protecting, and giving financial and systemic resources to those who have suffered at the hands of colonization and imperialism. Reparations are the only way to repair generational disparity. Reparations can never repair generational trauma. White people are drama. White people are drama. White people. Stop being drama. The Avronaut is here to uplift and fight alongside the diaspora. To undo the ignorance of the white people, and white-ish people, and non-black people, the Avronaut will define diaspora. Diaspora means people of an origin. Diaspora means black. Diaspora means of African or Afro-Island origin. Diaspora means displaced because of chattel slavery. Diaspora means indigenous Americans. Because the colonizers have harmed many. Because the colonizers have had the mic too long. Diaspora means the mic is ours now. The mic is ours now. The mic is ours now. The mic belongs to diaspora. The mic is for diaspora of past. The mic is for diaspora of present. The mic is for diaspora of future. The Avronaut is future black. Still the Avronaut hurts, but the Avronaut has made you all hurt and has returned to the colony. The Avronaut does not come in peace, but is made of peace. Peace is not quiet. Peace is the effect of colliding atoms until equality, equity, prosperity, and safety exist for all peoples. All peoples means diaspora. All peoples means diaspora. All peoples means all peoples, but especially diaspora. All peoples means we have hungered for hundreds of years, so the first serving belongs to diaspora. The first to be fed will now be diaspora. The Avronaut is not here to appease the white people and non-black people in this colony. The Avronaut did not risk everything to escape so that non-black could interrupt this mission. White supremacy will not interrupt this mission. The colony is ours now. The colony is ours now. The Avronaut controls the story and the ever-expanding narrative. Avronaut can deluge you with 1,000 histories, or expand one single image of disparity to crystal clarity and beyond. We will shape your vision to anything our imagination can conceive. The Avronaut will control all that you see and hear now. The Avronaut is landing. Please stand by. End transmission.
We plead to each other. We all come from the same rock. We all come from the same rock, ignoring the fact that we bend at different temperatures. Shri Murad, I am an enthusiast, not a rocketeer, but I would be exhilarated by the launch of each vessel carrying folks that were common once, now cosmonaut, now traveler of space. No illusion here, only heat. Guzzling, explosive, rocket topped with people bodies sweating until the engine stops. And you suddenly find your hairpick floating. A slow dance of plastic comb, but despite your affection for this common thing, you will still have to be wise to the others as they see your hair's the only hair on the ship that won't show signs of being in zero gravity unless it's abdicated from your own scalp. But my desire to leave here, leave atmosphere, leave breath and rainbows and snowfalls behind is expanding what I already know exists is possible because I have read about the laws of relative chattel gravity. But the dark matter of space still eludes scientists, looking for motives for no light. Theories of the dark that wear hood and carry volatile refraction. I am made yellow bone, but not passing enough to stop white dwarfed hands from making red of my bones try to integrate, but we get bullet clusters. It's the laws of space. I am not an astrophysicist. There isn't enough space in my gaping mouth for all of those bones and syllables and theories. But the proof of black stars is defined by the presence of luminous bodies orbiting what appears to be needless void. Black. I am code switch trained to black hole my AAVE. What's good, mirrored? Hello, officer. I see you, fam. Mirrored. Yes, your honor. I ain't fitting to be there. Mirrored. I plead when Sally Ride spoke of that feeling of breaking into zero G for the first time, she likened it to a gorilla pushing on her chest. Ain't that what it would be? I hope it was albino or blonde or anything but a pounding black. I am the new high, but equal opportunity without equal equity is just another closed airlock while begging ground control to end lockdown. I was sent out with only 3/5 the oxygen. Seems gender and color give fuel to friction for entry into career titles. We make it through sometimes, but not without pushing through fiery atmospheres until things get hot enough to be burnt along our blunt bodies, just trying to pass, but no passing here unless you are on the light side passing, but then your hair pick wouldn't be afloat, your hair would be weightless boogie until you cage it like the others who didn't chop it off before the mission. Maybe we weren't meant to stay here, cooped on this planet. How could we stay? Piled one atop another, only enough replacement sod for suburban sprawl. Ain't no sprawl here, only green in my hood is breaking concrete, trying to get light, trying to pass as garden or flower. But this color pushing peach gravel is unwelcome. Best remove it, best control it, best pull it out, watch it wither. Dark. If only these grounds could be control. If only these grounds could be safety. Maybe it's time for black to go to the moon. To stay there. Yes, I am colored. I am the absence. I am the vacuum. I am the void. I understand the matter as it is dark. Still, we all come from the same rock. We all come from the same rock. We all come from the same rock. We all do. Not just the privilege.
Say the law here is interacting is fine. It's welcome. My name is Mojdeh, also known as the Afronaut. We can talk about that a little bit later. I am an an Afrofuturist. I don't know if you can tell. I'm not wearing my galaxy shoes today, but that's a whole other story because #bedbugs, that's my roommate's problem. There are laws that me and my landlord has to take care of. So, I'm not going to tell you that much about me, but you guys can talk to me at any time afterwards because I want to also have enough time for the next performer. But I consider myself 2 part social practice artist, 1 part space cadet. I really appreciate some laughter when I say that. I also appreciate that people laugh when I tell white people to stop being trauma. Considering, yes, I'm the only person that can visibly be derivative of the African continent. I really appreciate that laughter. So most of my art is engaging anything that is really derivative of generational trauma. And I don't think I thought about it that way until the last few years. I do a lot of trauma-informed work. I'm an educator. I work with young people. I work with survivors of violence. But as I've come to this place in my life as a researcher and social practice artist, cultural worker, person out in the community doing direct service, and so forth, I've come to realize that each piece is really an excuse to talk about what is radical. I'm going to ask you guys what radical means in 2 seconds, or what is true from our history, right, and how we got here, and how we got to whatever prosperity or lack thereof we are existing in right now as individuals or as population. Can anyone define or explain what you believe radical to mean?
Disruptive of oppressive social orders.
Disruptive of oppressive social orders. Okay. I like that definition.
Thanks.
What else? Anyone?
Like a vision for something other than what is that isn't worried about maintaining or isn't worried about like disrupting on the way to get there?
That isn't worried about disrupting on the way to get there. Okay. What did you say again?
Disruptive of oppressive social orders.
Disruptive of oppressive social orders and not worried about disrupting. If you think about someone from history, semi-contemporary, so maybe, I don't know, 40s to now, can anyone name someone that you think many people in the room might know that you think is radical? I'm a teacher, I'll just start calling them people.
Angela Davis.
Angela Davis, why?
I think she is a public educator whose breadth of disruptive thought doesn't have any bounds, and she's like constantly thinking of new ways to disrupt oppressive social orders.
I like that. Anyone else? Anyone else you can think of? Radical. Someone you can think of from history that you think is radical.
Maybe a less well-known figure, but George Lewis.
George Lewis, why?
A person that reconceptualizes human social practices, improvisation.
Interesting. Okay. Let's get one more. Reconceptualizes to reconceptualize. One more?
This person is contemporary, but Mariam Kaba.
Why?
Mariam Kaba. Prison abolitionist.
Prison abolitionist. Yeah. Okay. All right. Can anyone name one, feature of radical that you think if somebody says radical, this is what they're thinking of, one kind of behavior trait? Something like that. Can a behavior trait be attached to radical? If so, what's one?
Confrontational,
amazing. Okay, cool. So the actual definition and etymology of radical means from the root. But at some point in history, when you had a lot of people speaking up,
it became a word attached to disruption, attached to recontextualizing, attached to not caring about disruption and things like this, which are not necessarily wrong. There was disruption. There was, you know, a boldness in many movements since slavery to now. But it is interesting how we've decided this word has changed, right? We have socially redefined it. So next time you need to read Webster, question perhaps the definition you're reading and whose lens decides what each of those words mean. It's probably not mine. This poem is called Skittles. It is for Trayvon Martin because it still hurts. After Anthony Rackler, Omar Holman, Jordan Peele, and Dr. Joy DeGruy, we segregated, humiliated, indoctrinated with false facts, burdened, generational with heinous acts, trauma, so familiar they name it our culture. Our children praise false fruits, hunger for aid, cool, flip their trash for cash, because our kids ain't fools. Once in a while, though, I treat myself to some Skittles. It's not a regular thing for me because I'm already watching for inevitable diabetes, maybe. I don't know. And the first three ingredients are sugar, corn syrup, and hydrogenated something death. I don't know. It's not a regular thing for me. But when I do, I buy them late night corner store compulsive. I like them in secret. Impatient strides, I wait to open them at home. I enjoy the process like pulse for sugar profit. Profit. At home, I tap pour them onto the counter and segregate them by color with a butter knife. This is actually real, I told you. As an unusual memorial for the ones who die first in horror films, I start with the fairest. Which means the lemon emoticon yellow, then the orange, then green apple, but before and after the permanent finish of purple grapple comes the berry red split spill. Because there is always blood before and after the dark meet their end. He said, stand your ground. Yes, you have to. So, sweet stand, gravel ground, lead lynch, black bodies matter, black matter. Bodies matter. Now that we've got the heavy ones out of the way, we'll do some more heavy ones, you know what I'm saying? It's funny, I started the Afronaut Project, which is an Afrofuturist, how do I describe this? It's a social experience that masquerades as a hip-hop and poetry project. Mm-hmm. And when I first conceived of it, I was like, I should start a project called Afronaut and the Afronauts, N-O-T, because I, for some reason, always make music with white people. Wouldn't that be funny? And I thought I'd make nothing but like joyful art, and then the more that I conceptualized this project, I was like, all right, we can make joyful art, but I think we're gonna have to talk about some real things, too. So while I am not bringing the super like Black Girl Magic pieces and so forth, they're in the works. They'll happen at some point, and you guys will come back, and it'll be wonderful.
party. And we'll all be there in Galaxy. I'm a little bit obsessed. I'm very excited that this was the one that y'all welcomed me to, by the way. I don't know if you guys were aware that I'm actually obsessed with law. My dad was an attorney, but didn't thrive. He went to a top 10 school, went to Northwestern Law School, and had a lot of trouble maintaining a legal position at any corporation, and then had trouble getting into any law firms. In the area that my mom wanted to live, I'm Afro-Persian, first generation on my mom's side, and she kind of didn't get that moving to certain areas of the country or even near the city would basically mean no work for my dad, right? Or difficulty, lots of challenges. So I still really appreciated like going with him to the office and reading through the books and going to the legal library and sitting in the courthouse and being like, cool, dad's talking about someone's traffic situation. Right? Cool. Dad helped people sign papers about a house and something went wrong. Like, right. He had a very thrilling career. but at some point, I learned about this thing called the plea deal. Does anyone know what a plea deal is? You have the most enthusiastic head now.
I don't know.
Does anyone else know what a plea deal is? So plea deal is basically an agreement that someone who has been charged with a crime is making to get a lower sentence in exchange for basically saying they're guilty. In our current system, because it's extremely predatory and extremely abusive, often a disproportionate number of mostly black people, but also some Latinx and indigenous, are forced into these plea deals, if for no other reason than the options are just like very, like if it's 30 years or 5 sometimes, right? Or life or 10 with parole, it's sort of a no-brainer. Of course you'd be like, yes, of course, but in that process not only do you for sure become a felon, right? And if you for sure become a felon, you for sure lose your voting rights. You for sure become a slave again, according to the 13th Amendment, and so forth, right? Difficulty getting jobs after you get released, so what good is being released again, and so forth. So I was thinking about what the plea deal is in its reality, but then also how we kind of make these plea deals all the time if you're at all other. Right, any kind of othered identity, we are constantly, or under-resourced identity, we're constantly making these decisions where it's like, well, it'll hurt me, but at least I'll be safer or better or have this resource if I choose to do this in a way that is acceptable to others. Or if it's the only way to get, you know, a certain resource for your children, it may not be the best way to do it, may not be the safest for you, or whatever, right? Just because of patriarchy, etc. So I wrote this triptych, which is the beginning of a manuscript that I'm working on, called Testimonies for the Plea Deals of Willing Scapegoats. One, the teacher. Make me uninvited guidance. These children will not be weeded. I showed them how to dandelion their way into better schools posing as flowers. Make me honey maker, noble protector, leave my stinger in their flesh necessary. Make me delicate and brave. Make shelter of my hands to keep polluting words from my students' gardens. Make me soil, rich with nutrient yet still dirt, or the fragile seeds from which a youth may bloom. Make me accidental Monsanto hybrid food desert gift. Make me flourish sick. Two, the Negro. Make me a new tale so that I may leave the old one distraction and no longer be prey.
Make me desert walker, skin like ash, ashy midnight water bearer, so that we chameleons may wash ourselves to glisten at dawn again. For cool, evaporating kisses of sun, better us reptile women don't boil. Make me married with equality without question for how my desert days made wrinkle of my purity to survive roadrunner men. Make me man maker, save God. 3. The Negro. The other one was the colored woman. I said the Negro. Make me equal. Make me created equally. Make me incarcerated for free future. Make me calm so that I may pursue happiness. Make me calm so that I may know liberty. Make me calm so that I may know life. Make calm safe. Make me under God indivisible safe. Make me safe. Make me safe. Make me safe. That's a deal I would take. Boom. How about 1990? Or 1919? Forgive me.
The race riot?
Say again?
Race riot?
Exactly, yes. So I've been working on a lot of writing around the race riots. I was asked to do a thing for the DuSable for the commemoration this summer of the Red Summer. And it was at the 31st Beach where there was a particular incident, famous incident here in Chicago, which is what ignited our sort of part of the Red Summer. And there's like an insane amount of text and an insane amount of trauma processing that happened through the process of this research. And from that, I distilled just this tiny little bit, which will probably expand into something greater. But this poem is about that incident. For now, it's called The Flood. Flood the beach, flood the streets, flood the city with the story of a drowned boy. Flood with heat, flood with heat. Flood the hearts of grieving blacks, flood the fists of whites with stones. Flood the white hands that drew out the flood. Flood with heat. Flood with heat. Flood the white hands making hailstorm of Chicago waters. Waters made red for at least one summer. Flood with heat. Flood the street. Flood the newspapers with stories. Flood the false coroner's report for Eugene Williams, which should have said a stone made flood of his head. Flood the streets. Flood the streets. Flood the streets. Flood the streets. Flood.
Would you like me to perform it by way of
dictating that a machine perform it? Or would you like me to perform one with my voice? Robot voice?
Your
voice.
Voice.
So choose your own adventure.
Your voice.
It's like
your
voice.
Voice.
Okay, bye. okay. Great. I am going to break the digital wall and hold my phone. I'm sorry.
It's okay.
I'm an old millennial. You have to understand, so this feels egregious to me. no matter how common it's become. Alright. I think the other reason I get frustrated is because right after I've pulled it up, it just disappears. So I am an educator, as I mentioned. I'm a non-traditional educator. Which means I do all these custom-built programs or curriculas that I've created to go into spaces and do specific work. Sometimes it's as simple, I come through like a SLAM history. I used to work for the guy that created the So What initiative. right, so sometimes it's just like, let's use our bodies and our voices, turn up. And sometimes it's really about like working on active trauma that we all know is trauma and everything in between, even when it's let's just use our bodies and our voices to like turn up. I'm still trauma-informed in approaching those workshops and approaching that, you know, English department takeover or whatever. From that perspective, even if it's a school in Grays Lake or a school on the South Side in the neighborhoods that we all think of when we think of South Side, right? As if there's not variance. Because trauma is relative, right? So one of the things that has become very important in sort of my research that fuels into my art has been the work of Dr. Joy DeGruy, whom I mentioned before performing Skittles. She's not a creative writer, so that was not an after poem, after her creative writing. She's a scholar that has theorized and very effectively brought together a lot of science and a lot of anthropology and a lot of history and so forth to propose the idea that we are experiencing something called post-traumatic slave syndrome. And I say that to, one, go listen to her speak. She's amazing. She's very charismatic. She will be in Chicago, actually, in like a week and a half, on the 7th. But, and on the 5th, they'll be screening one of her talks, same place. But the whole foundation of what she does is based on epigenetics. Does anyone know? Yes? So basically, what is it?
It's like trauma can be inherited through generations.
All the babies, and the babies' babies, and the babies' babies. So you can interrupt it, and different people respond to trauma differently. So you can have two twins, same exact life, more or less, but respond differently, right? But still, it's attached to the DNA. Trauma has happened, and I think it's a protein that attaches to the DNA and gives you that response to hopefully protect you, but it doesn't always work out that way, if any of us know anyone with general anxiety disorder, PTSD, etc. So this idea of trauma being relative, right? It's not just the descendant of the slave, it's also the descendant of the little girl that watched her preacher dad lynch the man, right? And everyone in between has lived through, you know, everything this country has made. One summer, I was teaching a program at Phoenix Military Academy, mostly Black and Latinx kiddos. And during the summer program, they welcome kiddos from other schools. We have populations that are butting heads, which historically makes sense if you're coming from certain neighborhoods. Your family may have come off the train and only been let off in that neighborhood because you are a field slave, or only let off in this neighborhood because you are a house slave, and everything in between, right? Because that's how the thing happened when people would come there. Though I'm not referencing that specifically in this poem, it is relevant because as I was teaching this program, I had taken it over from another educator, or
picked up the torch, so to speak, and one of the students had just come out as trans right before end of the school year. So it's a year-round program. I'm picking up for the summer. I roll in happily saying I'm genderqueer, but I say it once and then it moves on, and I don't even know if this kiddo was there for that day. And all summer, some of the kids from the other part of the city, every time I turned around to wipe the board, write something, go to the bathroom, whatever, were deeply bullying this child, right? And then I turn around and everything looks gravy. So the second to last day of program was probably the most violent interaction between students I've ever witnessed. And it was in a tight space. We were on a field trip on a bus. And so from that, I ended up writing this poem, which may never be memorized, because that would be a process of like trying to get my secondhand trauma, which is also its own separate trauma of watching the violence, to like resolve somehow, because that's the only way I can get that far to like actually memorize with some works. Sometimes I push it through, but without resolution. But if it's memorized, I've come to a healthier place. I don't know, we can ask my therapist, that's fine. I'm also Baha'i, which is a population that is very oppressed in my mom's home country. So as someone who has watched my dad, who is a person who lived through segregation, not succeed, and as a kiddo who was raised in a community that also didn't want my brother and I to succeed as much as they didn't want my dad to succeed, without language like microaggressions and without elders just chilling on the block to be like, you should read about Angela Davis. You should, you know, everything was just really a confusing, heavy situation. And there's a tension, at least in my home, that like because Baha'is are persecuted in Iran, my mom's home country, that it's the same. So I also have a complex relationship with faith, which is more information that I normally give before this poem, but I think it's useful. So because of that complex relationship, I found myself like praying through writing derivative of scripture. So not to read the scripture and just like take it in for its value spiritually and believe that I deserve it, but instead to take it in, let it sit, and if I can't create something of it, I don't actually believe I've prayed effectively. Which is complex things that I should probably, again, talk to my therapist about. But this poem is actually a hack of the Baha'i prayer for forgiveness, because I was finding it difficult to actually like hold the prayer, to say the prayer, to want the prayer, to believe that I deserved any kind of forgiveness, you know. So this poem is called Prayer for a Trans Student Whom I Failed to Shield from Being Bullied. Praise be the body, which is the reflecting water that holds thy likeness. Praise be. I am thy servant and this child the son, if thy wish it. I have set my face towards thy cause. I've turned each palm upward to carry the warmth this son cannot carry yet, because his hands are busy shielding his face, ears, and heart from his birth name, hurled upon him as hail bludgeons. I am steeped believing in the divine bounty of this child's avowal. Praise be. Praise be thy oneness, progressive, thy acknowledging of revelation of human form. I am called upon to be thy ally, recognizing thy creation of this boy, sovereign in choice. Praise be. I ask thee, by thy name through which the heaven was cleft asunder, the earth was rent in twain, the river Trent's current a rush, the mountains were crushed not to withhold from me, the
the breezes of thy mercy to turn this water at will. Praise be, O Creator, neither father nor mother, I no longer seek a gendered vision of thee, nor to suffer me to be far removed from the shores of thy nearness. I admit, I am the one who is sore athirst for common kindness among these children, yet caught in the floodplains of this river boy. Oh my Lord, the beat of orphan pronouns storming have made mudslide of these river boys' waters, these living waters of thy grace. I admit, I am but a poor teacher. Unknowing I was, as storm waters erode the soft soil into muck, my palms attempt to cradle this soft clay. I beseech thee, O my Lord, by thy mercy that hath surpassed the entire creation, and thy generosity that hath embraced all created things to cause me to turn my face wholly towards damming the waters a storm by voices of children not yet matured, so that this boy river may settle again into stable and defined shores. Powerful art thou to do what thou pleasest. Praise be, the ever forgiving, the all bountiful.